a molecular cluster. So I'm going to find it faster, searching through configuration of space. With the powers of computers, we'll understand sooner the birth of cloud condensation nuclei. Let me do some coding, I produce some program. Shooting as equations will solve all my problems. I never have to leave my chair even for a second. When science done, virtually, virtually no dead end.
Welcome, friends, to Sci Arts R Us again. Welcome to sort of our first episode of the Dissertation Dancing Talks. And today, for the very first time, we have four very special scientists or scientific artists or artistic scientists in our platform today. We are super excited to have Heather from the University of Oregon, Jakub, Ivo, and Vitas from the University of Helsinki in Finland. And these folks are not just scientists, they are actually artists as well. And as many of you have supported SciArts or us, you know, in at least a couple of our programs where we've tried to connect, you know, science and music, you know, as recently as the Hexagram series, where we try to explore arithmetic and geometry in classical music. We now have, you know, we're so lucky to have these folks who are exploring science and dance, believe it or not. They're trying to make science accessible through dance, and we cannot wait to talk to you guys. Welcome, Heather, Ivo, Jakub, and Vitas. Very nice to meet all of you.
Yeah, very nice to meet you as well.
Thank you so much. This is sort of a first for us at SciArts R Us, and I cannot wait to share what you guys have been doing in terms of, you know, exploring science and dance. And before, you know, we get into that discussion, I wanted to give a little brief intro about all of you to our audience that's joined us today. Heather is actually currently a fifth year PhD candidate in biochemistry and biophysics, and that's so close to my heart. Heather, because I am a biochemist myself by training. So she has been working at the Oregon State University. Apologies if I said, you know, something different earlier. Currently, you are working with Dr. Elisar Barber. Her work is focused on using a combination of molecular biology and biophysical methods to study the nucleocapsid phosphoprotein of the SARS-CoV-2 virus. This work has turned into a dance your PhD submission, winning new COVID-19 category. And in addition, Heather also uses TikTok and its trends, including songs, memes, and dances to communicate her science. And as a first generation academic, LGBTQ plus woman in STEM, uses the platform to provide resources, information, and advice about being a scientist. Fabulous, Heather. So inspiring. I mean, I've been seeing your TikTok videos, and there's so many of them that are fabulous. They're so informative. You know, I've been sharing it and I've been getting such positive feedback. Welcome to this session. You know, I'd like to turn it over to you just to say a few words before we go to the three, you know, bright graduate students from Finland.
Yeah.
How did you stumble upon this idea?
The TikTok idea or the dance your PhD idea?
I suppose, yeah, the dance your PhD, you know, dancing science to explain science. Yeah, how did you stumble upon this, Heather?
So I used to be a dancer through high school, and it's something that I've always loved to do for fun, and through graduate school, have taken a few dance classes as an elective to try and just sort of keep up with it as best I can. And I always wanted to do the Dance Your PhD contest since I knew it was a thing. Probably early on in my PhD is when I found out about it. Yeah. But I wanted to wait till I was closer to the end of my PhD to try and do it. And since they added the COVID-19 category this year, and I shifted my research focus to look at COVID-19 protein. I thought that this was the year to do it, and I'm almost done with my PhD now too. So that was the incentive for that. It just felt like the right time. And the TikTok I started doing just for fun at first with an undergrad who I was mentoring in 2019. And Gen Z is all over TikTok, and I just felt left out. And so I got on TikTok just for fun, and me and the undergrad at the time, Han, it was called the Get Up, I think. And it was a trending dance at the time. And that was our first like pretty viral video that got tens of thousands of views. And after that, I just kept using it to increasingly learn TikTok dances and adapt other memes or things that trend on TikTok when I was in the lab. And particularly when I started researching COVID-19, I thought that people would be really more ready to learn about like basic molecular biology if it was pertaining to something that was so relevant and pressing. And that turned out to be the case, like things that no one would ever, most people wouldn't be interested in learning about, they suddenly were. So that was a good opportunity, I think.
No, I think I couldn't agree more with you, Heather. And, you know, like I mentioned, like being a biochemist myself, I've been trying very hard to educate to the best of my ability, you know, about COVID-19, and everyone, non-scientists, everyone wants to know how does the vaccine work? What's the mechanism, you know, and this and that. And I think it was just like serendipitous, you know, discovery. When I saw the science article and I saw your name mentioned there, and I was like, wow, this is such a wonderful way to educate people on COVID-19. It's so relevant. I think it's fabulous what you're doing. And in just a little bit, we'll share a few videos as well of yours, Heather. You know, I just want to introduce the three graduate students from, you know, Finland first, and then we'll come back to our videos and just a little bit of discussion on, you know, how we can truly extend this, you know, beyond what we're doing with the Dance U PhD. So about the rappers from Helsinki, Ivo is a theoretical chemist. Hi, Ivo. His research is actually focused on the development of theoretical models to predict fundamental properties of chemical systems. Throughout his research, he has applied quantum chemistry methods in a variety of different fields, from material science to atmospheric studies. Ivo graduated from the KU Leuven, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, with the Bachelor of Chemistry in 2017 and an Erasmus Mundus Master in Theoretical Chemistry and Computational Modeling, summa cum laude, with congratulations from the Board of Examiners in 2019. And currently, Ivo, you're a doctoral student in the Computational Aerosol Physics Group in the University of Helsinki. And your research is focused on the development of a computational model to determine the fate of atmospheric clusters inside mass spectrometers and the change of the atmospheric cluster composition between intake and detection as a key hurdle in accurately measuring the exact concentrations of these clusters in the atmosphere and thus building reliable atmosphere models. The reason I'm mentioning this in so much detail is because, like, I'm sure, you know, even someone who's like a scientist like myself, this is almost something that I don't understand. So as non-scientists, I just want them to know what this is and how you guys have tried to explain something as complicated as this to folks to make it more understandable. But the important thing is, in addition to all this, Ivo is also an avid filmmaker, and he's completed his bachelor's in audiovisual arts from the Lucas School of Arts in Brussels, and you've created several short films that have been shown in film festivals around the world. Wow. What an interesting and amazing combination of talent, Ivo. Very happy to have you here today.
Yes, thank you. Happy to be here.
And I have to thank, you know, Jakub. I first reached out to Jakub when I came across the article, you know, to find out if we can have you on SciArts or Us. And a little intro to Yaqub. Since his childhood, Yaqub has been playing with chemicals. His late teenage experiments exploded the lab table. That exploded the lab table ended his experimental career. So he became a computational quantum physical chemist instead. And from Prague, he came to Helsinki in 2018 to study the structure and stability of molecular clusters, which are basically a group of molecules, and how they form in the atmosphere. He published several scientific articles, but mostly he likes to popularize science. Amazing, especially when it comes to educating the next generation of scientists. Amazing, Yaqub. And this so beautifully fits in actually with our mission in SciArts or Us, which is exactly what we're trying to do. Thank you for not only coming today, but also bringing Ivo and Vitus on board. Welcome.
Yeah, sure thing. Yeah, thanks for inviting us. Yeah.
My pleasure. Thank you. And finally, you know, last but definitely not the least, Vitus, you know, welcome, Vitus. You did your bachelor's in biochemistry. Yay, one more biochemist here. at Ludwig Maximilian University in Munich, after which you moved to Helsinki to study the master's track of theoretical and computational methods. Wow. So you went from biochemistry to theoretical and computational methods, and already parallel to his master's degree, he had started working as a research assistant for the computational aerosol physics group, in which he started his doctoral studies in 2020, after graduating in 2020. In his master's, he focused on the clustering of sulfuric acid and ammonia in the atmosphere and moved to research the utilization of machine learning and big data to understand the role of compounds and their oxidation products by vegetation. But in addition to this, Vitus, you had a passion for art, especially music, and you've been playing the guitar and you've been singing ever since you were a teenager. And in recent years, you've also turned to music production. At the same time, you're passionate about modern art. Amazing. We are super excited to have each and every one of you here. Scientists who embrace art, or artists who embrace science, whichever way we want to look at it. I cannot wait to talk to all of you about your goals, you know, going forward with regard to making science accessible. So let me turn the platform over to you. And, you know, have a little discussion about, you know, how did you guys come up, Yaqub, Ivo, and Vitus, with the idea of explaining molecular clusters via dance? That's quite an incredible thing.
Yeah, I think that I will go on. I love popularization of science, and from time to time, I see some YouTube video, and I see like somebody on YouTube, actually our friend of ours, did dance your PhD in past, and I was so amazed by that. And I decided, okay, this is actually a very nice way how to present the science. It's like all the scientists should learn how to talk about their science. And sometimes it's interesting if you give it in different way. Whatever, poem, performance, art, like dance, music, so on. And dance your PhD was something what I wanted to do, but I was just maybe lazy, and Vitus was the one. Maybe Vitus, go on and tell how you pushed me to do it.
Like, I guess we somewhere in the beginning of 2020, we just talked about it and then we forgot about it. Mm-hmm. And then in the beginning of September, I think we met at a lunch, and I just the day I thought about it, and I really felt like I wanted to do something for music. So I was like, I met Yaqub there and I told him, Yaqub, we've got to start this now, because I really, really want to make a song for that. So this was kind of actually my first incentive to do it. And I think, yeah, a few days later, we sent the first email and we were like, got Ivo on board.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, let's do that.
And this was actually the very good combination. I like the popularization of science. Vitus is the music guy.
I was going to say,
Yeah, yeah, you was expert on the video editing, and I think that next year Heather should go with us because she is awesome dancer.
Yeah, that was our problem. Like we had film, we had video, we had science, but we just didn't have dance.
Yeah, okay. We were trying our best, but yeah.
Yeah, you guys make a great team. You know, like each of you has a different artistic strength, and it's just perfect. And to your point, Heather's a fabulous dancer. So yeah, you know, maybe a collaboration next year or something. But you know, guys, I wanted to ask you. So you know, I've seen some of your videos. I've seen Heather's TikTok videos. I was very curious to know. You know, I know Heather's focus is more on sort of biochemistry. And you guys have been doing some presentations on molecular clusters. So I'm wondering, how do you choose what song or what dance moves to make for a given topic? Is that something you think about in a scientific way? Or you think like, oh, this particular concept, we need to have this particular song because it's tougher to understand. So we need to make it more, like a particular kind of dance move, or is it usually quite random? Have you seen, like, for example, Heather on TikTok, if you've chosen a particular kind of song or dance, you've seen greater views or greater hits or comments versus something else?
Yeah, I think that the first one Ivo came up with the molecules, right? The molecules are objects that are vibrating and rotating and so on. So there was quite huge inspiration. Let's try to mimic the movement of molecules or clusters, so vibrate somehow. So throughout the video, there are some people who are trying to vibrate. And then when it comes to the cloud formation and the grouping of molecules, yeah, I think that we were trying to do some movements which were inspired by the events that we are trying to describe. So yeah, when we are talking about whole cloud or how the single molecules come right together, so there is certainly some inspiration based on what we are talking about.
That's very nice. So Heather, I was curious, and you have several videos, and I was wondering how your thought process on this was.
Yeah, so for the Dance Your PhD submission in particular, I thought really carefully about how I thought that protein would move and tried to be very intentional about like, okay, well, I'm trying to get across this concept, so I need to be like more flexible and in motion, or for this concept, it needs to be like more rigid. But for my TikToks, it's a lot more variable because I try to follow whatever is trending at the time. So I have the most success on TikTok whenever there's a song, and you can see on the app like what is the number one song on TikTok right now. If I use one of the top 10, or if there's a dance that like everyone is doing, then I'm more likely to get people to engage with it because they are interacting with people who are doing that dance and not necessarily looking for scientific content. And on top of that, I think that it's really successful if the song complements it at all. So one of my most successful videos was there was a Megan Thee Stallion body challenge is what it was called. And the song repeats the word body over and over again. And I did the trending dance and also talked about antibodies and getting the vaccine in the text that pops up. And that, I don't know what it's at now, but close to 800,000 views, it got on TikTok very, very quickly. And like, I think that's something really amazing about TikTok that other platforms, it's harder to like bring it to people who aren't necessarily searching for that information. And you can do it specifically through dance. And sometimes I'm more intentional about it than others, I would say.
I think it's an interesting perspective. You know, while you were talking, Heather, I was thinking, I think there's two angles to what you all are doing, right? One is making science like popular, like Jakub was saying, right? So the entertainment aspect of science, which, you know, focuses a little more on the entertainment. And then, you know, whatever little education that happens in that process, that's great, right? It's better than nothing. And then the other aspect is the scientific education with the entertainment, sort of the media to help transmit that information, right? So I know, you know, TikTok, for example, most of the videos are, you know, short, right? Like they're 30 seconds, a minute. So I was kind of wondering, and even those take a lot of time because, you know, whether it's you guys, you know, doing it for Dance Your PhD or like Heather's videos where she's doing, you know, these little snippets explaining her publication, there's a lot of animation, right? So there's also animation that goes with the dance and the video. And I was thinking when I was watching this, you know, if we were to do this live, right? Right now we're doing a lot of these videos as well because of the pandemic. But if we wanted to do something like this live, like we have a little workshop, you know, where we're trying to teach people science, whether it's biochemistry or molecular clusters, would you think that the lack of animation in a live session would make it harder to relate to the folks who are listening? Or is there a way around it?
I think it probably depends on the concept. But if you introduced a topic to people and then had them engage with it through movement or creating their own animations and collaborating with others, I suspect that it would be pretty successful. But I think that humans are pretty visual learners off, like overall, and having like a good starting point is maybe important for learning and like growing that creativity on top of it.
Right, absolutely.
I also think that the Denture PhD videos, I think that both of us made is that they were specifically made to be videos and with the animation. So if you would do something in like a workshop environment more, I think you cannot just extrapolate the things that we've done there to this workshop environment, but you would have to really build something from the ground up specifically for that environment.
Correct. Yeah. So I think, you know, this is really, I think, just scratching the surface, and already you all have made so much progress in looking at science so differently. And, you know, back when I was in graduate school doing my PhD, I don't think Science Magazine had the Dance Your PhD contest. I think this is relatively recent, right, over the last several years. And, you know, I really wish we had something like this, especially I think when, you know, when you're a TA and you're even teaching your undergrads, it would be really cool to have these kind of teaching aids and get, you know, undergrads interested in your, and we would have these lectures, you know, with hundreds of students, and, you know, invariably you'll lose a few students who are sitting in the back, right? And I think animation videos like this would really keep the interest in the subject. I think it's a great tool. And I think I was mentioning to you guys, you know, I've been talking to a professor at UCLA as well, who's been trying to incorporate these concepts in his, you know, teaching on a regular basis. And we're gonna have him over in our platform as well. And maybe we can all get together at some point with him. You know, before we move on to the next questions, I kind of wanted to share you guys' videos for our audience so they know, you know, what it is that we're talking about. You know, a few of the snippets from Heather's and both of your Dance Your PhD videos. If this is a good time, I'd love to share that.
Like, hello, beautiful. Cause this world is so crazy, and it can bring you down. You're too short, too fat, too skinny. Hey, well, excuse me if I. think that I'm.
I don't want no minute man.
So the audience that's tuned in, you know, you guys got an idea of the kind of work that Heather does. And in fact, it's quite similar, I think, to what the students from Finland are doing as well. So Heather, this, to me, you know, I've been seeing all your videos and I find your explanation of your publications, you know, to be very interesting. I know there was a paper that you've been going through different parts. And I was wondering, you know, do you plan on doing this for all your publications, like where you're going to explain every paper, every figure, every concept? I mean, kind of what's your thinking? I was so inspired to go back to my old publications and try to explain it to folks. You know, what are your plans with the paper aspect?
So I wanted to primarily go through, or for sure go through this paper, because this is the paper that has been on the last year in the making, and it's the paper that my dancer PhD submission was based off of, and it's related to COVID-19. So I thought that my followers would particularly be interested in that. Assuming I get another paper about COVID-19 out before I finish my PhD, I'll probably do something similar about that one. If it seems like there's interest for it. I don't know if I'll go back and do it with other publications or what I'll do in the future exactly. I kind of have been adapting to like what my followers respond well to and what they want to know at the time.
Yeah. May I ask? I saw in some videos that when you are making those videos where you are dancing, your lab mates are working and yeah. are people watching you when you are making those videos?
Yes, I try to. So usually I make them like at the end of the day, it's the last thing I do, and there's only like one or two people still around, or I try to make them if no one is around, ideally. But that's getting harder and harder to do. A lot of my lab mates have guest starred in my TikToks, and they are just kind of used to it now. The hardest thing is just making sure that I've like positioned myself where I'm not going to be in their way to do this recording very quickly. Usually I learn the dances. I think we showed a clip of, there's a side-by-side of me and Charlie is her name. She's like one of the top two or three most followed TikTok stars. And, so I learn these dances from these like trending teenagers and then record myself doing it and then add like scientific content over it. So usually I learn the dances at home, and then whenever I'm like waiting for something to incubate or just like waiting for something to do whatever, there's a lot of waiting in biochemistry.
Oh yeah.
So I just record them whenever I have some time or at the end, and my lab mates are just kind of used to it and think it's pretty entertaining, I think.
Yeah, it's super cool. You know, I was going to say, you know, your advisor, I would love to meet your advisor too. She must be a very, very fun, cool mentor. That's simply amazing. And you just record with your cell phone when you...
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I usually just, in the past, I've just like set my phone up against something in the lab. I now have a like ring light and what is it called? Like a little stand that can hold my phone. So it's a little easier. But then I look really extra walking around the department with like this hand to record my dancing. But It makes better videos, so.
It's totally impressive. And you know, Evo Vitis and Jakub, I know you guys are working on something right now, and maybe you're not in a position to share it just yet with all of us, but are you guys also kind of thinking on these lines on explaining your dissertation, or are you picking up other concepts in molecular clusters that you want folks to understand? I'm kind of curious to know what areas you're focusing on.
Like one more close thing we want to do over the next few months, I would say, is that we are working on a new video for our YouTube channel. So we want to explain concepts of sulfuric acid and what it did in, like, which roles it was playing in the history of mankind in some way. Wow. And we tried to do it in like a hopefully fun, entertaining way. But for like more long-term things is that we will definitely try to dance Evo's PhDs and mine too, because like we are all like roughly 1 year apart. So this was mainly Jakob's topic. And then the next one would be Evo's, and the one after would be mine. And we are not having something very concrete, but it's just nice to play already around with ideas or music.
Absolutely. You know, I just wanted to tell the audience that's tuned in, you know, who are not scientists, or, you know, to get an appreciation of this, you know, getting your PhD done in a given subject is hard enough, right? Getting through graduate school, 5+ years, you know, getting through all the obstacles, getting your publications, getting your results. And these guys have taken it to another level. You know, it's not just doing your research, getting your papers and graduating. Now they're dancing, and making these, you know, videos takes a hell of a lot of time. It's not a joke doing this. And being a graduate student, I know, you know, having been there, you're working all night, all day, just, you know, stressed out, trying to get your publications out, getting your experiments to work. And, you know, hats off to you guys for doing this, making it fun. You're inspiring graduate students, you know, who are kind of getting through this process to make it more fun. You're educating non-scientists, and you're educating even children. I feel I was showing this to my, you know, 12-year-old son and my 10-year-old daughter, and they were like, wow, you know, they learned something about science already. So I think you guys are definitely onto something really impactful, and I'm so happy to have you guys. And I know everyone's wondering, what is this Dance Your PhD video that these guys are talking about? So I want to share that with our audience, if this is an okay time to do that. And in fact, to give an appreciation of what it takes, I'm also going to share the making of the Dance Your PhD video that Evo Vitis and Jakub shared. So hold on just a second when I share this with you guys.
I get ready?
Yes. Super early.
Close enough.
What? Perfect. Your head a bit lower.
Your pen.
Okay. I'm ready. Look at us. Genius and the spirit scientist going to again.
What? Again?
Again.
We are looking for molecular clusters. I'm trying to find them faster. Searching through configuration in space.
When the cluster has reached a certain size, water starts to condense. It's a cloud droplet. Surprise! Now we want to understand the start of this process. We will use chemistry, physics, and computers in excess.
Okay,
that was too slow. The first thing, you are too quiet. You need to be closer to the microphone.
Okay.
I don't have my lyrics. La 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 la. Blah 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 blah. Da 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 da. I don't. La 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 la. Ba ba da da da. Ba 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 ba.
Yeah. So recording.
Is it starting?
Yes. Okay, now.
Okay. Let me tell you something about atmospheric aerosols. They form right in the atmospheric gaseous because the first single molecules come and cluster together. That is sulfuric acid.
It's a base.
Which whatever.
Action! Can we restart immediately?
Yeah, this is what they say.
No, I'm really out of
it. Yeah, good!
No, no, no!
2, 3,
don't, four, your legs not
five,
too outside. Yeah, perfect.
7, 8, 9, 10.
Perfect.
11, 12, 13.
Now
40,
you're diving, yeah.
50.
Same thing.
Ah, you might be hard to
see. Go, let's go.
I didn't get
come
the
over here.
Let me tell you something about secondary aerosols. They form right in the atmosphere from gaseous precursors. First single molecules come and cluster together. That is sulfuric acid with some base, which whatever.
Ammonia or DMA, highly oxygenated compounds. All of them suitable to form with the acid strong bonds. Once the cluster has reached a certain size, water starts to condense. It's a cloud droplet surprise. Now we want to understand the start of this process. We will use chemistry, physics and computers in access.
We are looking for molecular clusters. We're trying to find them faster. Searching through configuration.
What's up? University of Helsinki 2020.
Gotcha, macha, gotcha.
Vitas, Jacob, Evil, in the house.
Put your mask on, wash your hands.
Vitas, let him have it.
Let me tell you something about secondary aerosols. They form right in the atmosphere from gaseous precursors. First single molecules come and cluster together. That is sulfuric acid with some base, which whatever.
Ammonia or DMA, highly oxygenated compounds. All of them suitable to form with the acid strong bonds. Once the cluster has reached a certain size, water starts to condense. It's a cloud droplet surprise. Now we want to understand the start of this process. We will use chemistry, physics and computers in excess.
We are looking for molecular clusters. We're trying to find them faster. Searching through configuration in space. With the powers of computers, we'll understand sooner the birth of cloud condensation nuclei. Let me do some coding. I produce a program. Turing as equation will solve all my problems. I never have to leave my chair even for a second. When science done virtually, virtually no dead end.
Fine, I'll do it myself. Woo! For arranging molecules, there are very many ways. They rotate or translate and vibrate in space. We have some programs that explore all the possibilities and others to refine the results energetically. Once we collected and evaluated all the data, we feed them to advanced models to analyze them faster. Atmospheric cluster, dynamics code, short AC-DC, predicts cluster formation rates fast and easy peasy. In the big picture, we wanna understand the climate, predict weather phenomena and be ready to time it, time it, time it, time it.
We are looking for molecular clusters. We're trying to find them faster. Searching through configuration in space. With the powers of computers, we'll understand sooner the birth of cloud condensation nuclei. Let me use some coding. I produce a program. Turing as equation will solve all my problems. I never have to leave my chair even for a second. When science done virtually, virtually no dead ends.
Hey, listen up, nerds. This is how you find clusters.
1. Turn on the computers. 2. Get your molecules and put them together. 3. Explore the configurational space. 4. Optimize these structures. 5. Filter out the crap. 6. Congratulations, you found your cluster. 7. Cash in the Nobel Prize.
We are looking for clusters.
We're trying to find them faster. Searching through configuration of space. With the powers of computers, we'll understand sooner the birth of cloud condensation nuclei.
Look at us, genius atmospheric scientists, going to add science to our publication list.
We are peerless,
accepted without review,
submissions fearless,
high metrics on the menu.
Coffee is my fuel and sole means of hydration. When I'm busy fighting, writing my dissertation.
We set the bar so high, it's statistically significant.
Your mom says hi, I taught her to extrapolate my constant.
My papers are flawless, your impact is abysmal.
I'm the first author and you are just et al. Et al. Et al. Et al.
So, that was an awesome, awesome performance, you guys. And to the audience that's tuned in, you got to see what the making of a video like this is, and you saw the final product. Incredible amount of effort. You guys did a fabulous job. I think I have an understanding of what molecular clusters are now. So after seeing the video, at least on some level, I get to understand what you guys are doing. Thank you so much for sharing that. And everyone's been waiting also for Heather's Dance Your PhD contest video. In just a moment, we'll be sharing that as well.
All of your cells have double-stranded DNA. But to be used, your genes have to be transcribed into single-stranded RNA. RNA carries building instructions that are translated into proteins. Proteins have different capabilities and jobs depending on their size, their building blocks, and their shape. A SARS-CoV-2 viron responsible for the COVID-19 disease is made up of a few key proteins: the spike, envelope and membrane proteins, and inside the viron, many nucleocapsid proteins attached to the viral RNA. Understanding this RNA packaging by nucleocapsid proteins is important for understanding viral replication and viron structure.
I'm the brains and the brawn.
More structured proteins are rigid, locked in place for their specific role. More disordered proteins are flexible, sampling many states. The nucleocapsid protein of SARS-CoV-2 has disordered parts, a structured RNA binding region, and a region that binds to copies of itself. We use a giant magnet called an NMR to better understand the structure and flexibility of the nucleocapsid protein. Lots of proteins tumble in liquid inside of the NMR, with all of its atoms having their own magnetic field. The magnetic cores have their own nuclear spins, and inside the magnet, radio frequency pulses cause spins to align. More pulses result in a unique image for a protein that can tell us about its structure, movement, and the chemical environment.
I'm just a rock star.
To better understand the full-length nucleocapsid protein, we break it apart into smaller parts first and compare these to the full protein and find out what section is responsible for what function. The way legs are responsible for kicking, but arms for guitar playing. We then compare the free nucleocapsid protein to the nucleocapsid protein with RNA around and see how and where and under what conditions the protein binds and changes structure or motions. What we see is that along the genomic RNA of SARS-CoV-2, many nucleocapsid proteins start to attach using their structured regions, but their disordered domains stay flexible. Over time, the RNA nucleocapsid protein complex starts to stabilize, eventually resulting in a fully formed viron center.
I'm speaking.
Now that we know more about how the nucleocapsid protein is shaped and how it moves under normal conditions, we can modify the protein with mutations or post-translational modifications to see how it impacts the protein and its function. As we learn more about how RNA binds, we can develop drugs that block RNA binding, which would disrupt the virus's ability to replicate.
When you gold medals.
The COVID-19 pandemic has been devastating, but working on the SARS-CoV-2 virus has shown how quickly science can move when scientists communicate and collaborate openly and combine resources towards a common goal. The pandemic has resulted in a worldwide halt and adaptation to life, showing new ways of living and exposing systems and environmental impacts that can and should change. The general public has followed and become involved in science more than ever before, giving scientists a unique opportunity to share their work and talk about the scientific process.
Wow, that was incredible, incredible, Heather. I absolutely enjoyed every second of it. Between your video and you guys, Jakub, Ivo, and Vitus, you guys' video, I can see the amount of time and effort and thought that's gone into this. Just like bravo, you guys did an awesome, awesome job. And to end this interview today with Heather's video, it's such a powerful message about COVID-19, educating everyone about this. And at the same time, what you said is so true. Scientists have come together now in collaboration, and how quickly we've now obtained a vaccine and we're progressing and, brilliant message from both of you guys. I hope our audience that tuned in really enjoyed this as well. Before we sign off, guys, is there something you would like to say about your future plans? Anything at all that you'd like to share with all of us?
Yeah, I hope that we all will continue somehow popularize science via art. Yeah, because that's important too. And I especially like when it's education of the next generation of scientists, but also the audience, broad audience should know about the science, because science cannot progress if if we are not all on the same board.
I would like to go ahead, Heather.
I was just gonna also say that I hope to continue to keep doing science communication efforts, and I'm finishing my PhD in the next few months and hoping to transition into a career that is focused more on that, actually. And still not exactly sure what that is yet, but hoping to get more involved in these efforts, I think, than I have been able to be in grad school. And I hope that more people start to see the value of it as well. I think there's just not enough effort and money and appreciation going into these efforts. And we and, you know, other people, but just not enough people are having to put a lot of time into it. And it's usually not, you don't win money for it every single time. And I hope that the scientific community will get ever more diverse in terms of educational efforts and practices and methods.
No, I think that's those are some very good points, Heather. I know Eva wanted to say something, and then we'll come back with some concluding remarks.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that in the end, maybe we put like a lot of time into it, but we started quite early, and like we did just every week a little bit of it. So maybe like the full thing in itself looks very daunting, but in the end, like if you just do a little bit of this kind of like popularization of science every week, or you work a little bit on a video or a dance or whatever, then it becomes very manageable and you get into a habit of doing things. And I think a lot of scientists are a bit anxious to start this, one because of the amount of time that goes into it, and also because of like an anxiety of like, is it going to turn out okay? But I think like by doing it, you learn more things about how to make these kind of videos or how to do these kind of art projects. And it doesn't have to be a huge amount of time at one go, but you can just like work on it throughout the thing. So I would just like encourage like all scientists to do a little bit of popularization of science, and that over time you will also hone your skill and becomes easier and easier to do those kind of things.
Absolutely. Vitus, did you have anything to add as well?
Well, I think maybe it's also time for thanking everyone who's like watched it and appreciated it and shared it and helped us share this message, because like making a video is one thing, but it's also important. Like, thank you very much, Rangini, for having us and for giving us some platform through which we are given the opportunity to spread our message. And I hope that many people will see it and will be inspired by it.
Oh, thank you, guys. I think, you know, what you're doing fits in so beautifully with the mission of SciArts or Us. And I was kind of thanking my stars for having, you know, bumped into you guys' videos, you know, being a scientist and, you know, sort of an artist, you know, but more of an art aficionado or a promoter. I think I see exactly what you're saying, Yakub. I think these days, you know, technology is more accessible even on our phones. So I think as scientists, we should, you know, go out of our comfort zone and not get too intimidated, you know, by what we think is hard about making a video or explaining, you know, concepts such as these. I think it's relatively easy these days. And if every graduate student can, you know, spend a little bit of time trying to explain a little bit of what they're doing, it doesn't even have to be, you know, a long video, something short to just convey. I think we'll have more people join us in this process. And I want to thank all four of you for spending your precious time talking to all of us and sharing your videos. We at SciArts R Us look forward to working with you in the future as well in whatever capacity we, you know, make sense to you guys and us, and look forward to having you over when your next new videos come up, and we'll share it with everyone.
Thanks so much for having us.
Yeah, thank you. You know, have a lovely day, you guys, and I know it's like night time for you there in Finland, so good night, you guys, and bye, Heather. Thank you so much for joining us, and stay in touch, and thank you, audience, for tuning in to watch this very unique series. Bye, you guys.
Acid roof, some base, which whatever.
Ammonia or DMA, highly oxygenated compounds, all of them suitable to form with days in strong bounds. Once the cluster has reached a certain size, water starts to condense. It's a cloud droplet surprise.